Okay, welcome to calculus. So what's today, the 23rd? So last time we were talking about volume, and we'll do one last exercise with volume until we move to a different topic. So please find the volume of the solid of revolution obtained by revolving y is e to x about the x-axis on the interval 0 to 2. And provide a sketch. Okay, so if we're going to sketch this object, then we need to know what y is e to x looks like. So how does that look? Yeah, like several people made the hand gesture. Okay, so then y is e to x looks like this. Y is e to x. So we just want to cut a piece of it out. We don't want all of that. We just want to cut a piece of it out and then just rotate that piece. So we just want the piece between 0 and 2. So here's 0, and here's 2. So we take this much of the exponential function, and then we're going to revolve it about the axis.
When we're drawing, and when you say sketch, do we need to draw that little arrow?
This thing?
Show, yeah.
Please do, yeah. Okay. So it's not an art class, right? But it does need to be reasonable. Like this one needs to be a reflection of that one, more or less. Okay, so then this is like a really fancy lampshade. And instead of like the other one last time where the sides were flat, this one flares a little bit. So it's fancy. Okay. And this is a solid object. Okay, so that's the object that we're trying to find the volume of. What is the formula for the volume of this object?
Take the paper.
Integral, yes.
From 0 to 2.
Yes, 0 to 2.
Pi.
Mm-hmm.
Radius over height. R over h is what I have.
Ah, so that's the previous example from last time when we were trying to find the, we were trying to establish the volume of a cone.
Pi e to x. But yeah.
And then this square. Right, dx. So the formula that we're using is the formula that looks like this. Integral a to b pi f of x squared dx. So, and in this case, a and b are 0 and 2, and f of x is e to x. Okay, so then as for this integral, we want to use the fundamental theorem, which means we want to find an antiderivative. So is this one of the antiderivatives that we know? No, it's not one of them. Is there something algebraic we can do to turn it into one of the antiderivatives that we know? What algebraic thing can we do? Okay, the pi can come out. I agree, because it's a constant. Right.
Multiply
the exponents, which is to say that this could be written as pi. Someone said take the pi out, so I did. And then 0 to 2. And this is e to 2x dx. And what has been used here is that x to m to n, when you have exponents that are iterated like this, how do you combine them? By multiplying them. So this is x to the m n. So we combined e to x to 2 as e to 2x. Okay, now is this one of the antiderivatives that we know? It is, right? This is the e to kx. So what is the antiderivative of e to 2x?
E to 2x.
Yeah, e to 2x divided by 2. Okay, and I've made a nice error here. Didn't carry the pi down, right? So I only point this out because this kind of error is quite common. So this pi that I'm writing in red was formerly missing. Okay. So then just a little bit of simplification. This would be pi over 2. And then we need to evaluate this expression at 2, so that'd be e to 4. And then what is e to 2x evaluated at 0?
1.
1. So minus 1. And what if, let's say that the exercise said give it to two places past the decimal. Right, then you use the machine here. So pi over 2 times e to 4. Minus 1. So my calculator is reporting 84.19. What is the meaning of that number, 84.19?
It's
not area.
Volume.
It's volume, right? So if this diagram was measured in centimeters, say, then that would be saying that the volume of this object is 84.19 centimeters, cubic centimeters. Good. Any question about this? Any question about it? Okay. So now, something new. Something old and something new. So what if I gave you three numbers? So I gave you three different numbers, and the instruction was that I want you to find their average. What would you do? Add them together and divide by three, okay? So if I gave you five numbers, you'd add them together and divide by three.
No, five.
Oh, you're okay. You'd divide by five, okay? Right. So then to find average, there's in a sense two distinct things occurring. You sum everything, and then you divide by the size of the things that you were summing, right? So if you were summing 10 things, it's the sum of these 10 things over 10. If you were summing 10 million things, the sum of these 10 million things divided by 10 million. Okay? So, yeah, I would never give you an exercise like that. So, generally speaking, given n numbers, v1, v2, dot, 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 vn to vn, the average is what we said, right? You add them all up, v1 plus v2 plus dot, 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 plus vn. You add them all up and then divide by n. But this numerator, the notation in that numerator is a little clumsy. Don't we have a nicer notation for that?
No.
Not integral.
The
E. The thing that looked sigma. Good. So this would be sigma sum from I is 1 to n of vi over n. So that's just a shorter way to write sum. And then you can write this all in a single line by writing 1 over n sum from I is 1 to n of vi. Okay, so that's average. That's something that you knew from way back, right? So now we want to have a slightly different consideration. Since this is a calculus course, what if there's infinitely many numbers? Right, this is the case when there's a million numbers or 10 million numbers. What if there's infinitely many of them? What if we have the following scenario? So given f is continuous on a to b, which is to say that we have a scenario that looks like this. So here's some function f. We want to find the average value of f. The average value of f on a to b. Now, how many different values does f take on? Or how many places can f be evaluated?
Two.
Infinitely many places, right? It can be evaluated at infinitely many places, and at least this particular f takes on infinitely many values. So we want to know, what is the average value? What's the average value of f? Okay, so just like, what is the average value of this set of numbers? What's the average value of this function on this interval? Okay, so the way we're going to address the question is as follows. So we're going to say, okay, let's try sampling f. let's try sampling F at a few different places, which is to say that we'll subdivide this interval. And so at each one of these, at each one of these places, we'll evaluate F, and that gives us, say, that value, and that value, and that value, that value, that value, that value, that value, and that value. So on my particular drawing, there are eight tick marks, really nine if you count this left one, but I'll say eight. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So we evaluated F at eight places. Now, how could we find the average of just those eight values?
Add them up and divide by
eight. Yeah, add them up and divide by eight. Right. So what I'm claim and what I'm telling you is that's an estimate for the average value of F. If we were to do that, that would be an estimate. We could say, well, let's sample it at eight points and then compute the average in the grade school way. And what if that estimate was not good enough? If we wanted it to be more accurate, then what could we do?
More points.
Sample at a finer resolution. Instead of 8, maybe 80 or 80 million. And then what's the calculus point of view? Just go ahead and just do it at infinitely many places. Okay, and let's just see what happens. So what we're going to do is we're going to see, what if we take this idea of sampling F and we take it to its logical conclusion and say, let's just use infinitely many samples. Okay? So in order to build that up, we need to define some things. So we're going to subdivide the interval A to B into N equal size pieces. Of size. So what is the size if we subdivide the interval A to B into N pieces? What's going to be the formula for the size? So what if we had an interval of length 10 and we wanted to subdivide it into two pieces? What would be the length of each piece?
Five.
So I can't make a five with a pen in my hand. What if we had an interval of size 10 and we wanted to subdivide it into 20 pieces? How long would each one be?
Half.
How are you obtaining this?
Division,
right?
Yeah,
you're dividing. So
is it a trick question?
what if you had something of length 10 and you wanted to divide it into n equal pieces? Then what?
Divide by n.
Well, 10 over n, right? So then what is the size of each piece when you divide the interval A to B into n pieces?
So A to B.
So what is A to B?
B minus A over N.
B minus A over N. B minus A over N. And hopefully by this point, bells are starting to ring, because not too many lectures ago we had given a name to B minus A over N. What name did we give to B minus A over N? So what we're saying, what this sentence and this consideration is saying, it's saying that each one of these little intervals has the same size, B minus A over N. And we gave a name when we broke a bigger interval into little intervals, and we gave a name to the size of each one. Do you remember? No, we don't remember. Okay, so delta X.
It's all coming back.
It's coming back. The bad memories that we thought we
yes, I'm just really scared
repressed.
We're going to go down that rabbit hole trail again, and I really
we're going to. Here it comes.
Awesome.
Okay. So each one of these are A is x0 less than x1 less than x2 less than dot 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 less than xn is B, which is to say that now we're going to name each one of these fence posts, and their name is whichever one they are. So this one is x0, and then x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, all the way to xn. So there's all those places. So the average value, or let's say it like this, the samples of F are well, the first sampling point is x1. So what is the value at x1?
x1 minus 1.
It's f at x1, right? You plug it, you plug in it, plug in the x1 into f. So the samples are x1, f at x1, and then f at x2, dot dot dot, all the way to f at xn. Okay, so what is the average of this sample? These are just n numbers, so what's the average?
F at xn minus f at x1 over n?
No. So what was the average of these numbers?
Oh, e thing.
Yeah, you add them up and divide by n. So the average of these numbers is the same. You add them all up and divide by n. So f at x1 plus f at x2 plus dot 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 plus f at xn, and then all of this over n. And then don't we have a nicer notation for this? Yes, right? The sigma thing. So 1 over n summation from I is 1 to n of f of xi.
What's on top?
On top of what?
The sum.
Summation from I is 1
yeah.
to n. Okay. So now, because 1 over n doesn't have any i's in it, any of the index variable, I, 1 over n can come inside of the sum. So it's just like distributing into a sum. So I'll do that. So this will be the sum from I is 1 to n of f of xi, 1 over n. So now at this position, what information have we not used? So what of this information have we not used here yet?
A and B.
Okay, we haven't used the A and B, and in particular we haven't used
the less than
this.
Oh.
This. We're using all of these, x0, blah blah blah, because we're using them here.
Okay.
So this is b minus a over n. So delta x is b minus a over n. So we have a 1 over n. We have a 1 over n. And wouldn't it be nice if this was a B minus A over N, but it's a 1. Right? If only we could make it be B minus A.
I have a feeling.
Okay, so let's try and make it happen. So what we're going to do, we're going to take this sum. And out front here, we're going to multiply by 1. Because right? You can always multiply by 1. And what we really need to do is we, in a sense, need to cleverly choose what that 1 is going to be. So sum from I is 1 to n, f of x I 1 over n. So what do we need? What do we need this 1 to be?
B minus A.
Well, that's, you know, if I just write B minus A here, then that's not 1.
Oh, B minus A over 1.
Over B minus A, yes. So that's 1. Okay. So now B minus A, that's just a constant. So I'm going to factor it in also and give the numerator to 1 over n, so it'll be b minus a over n. So like this. So I move the numerator over here, and I'll leave the denominator outside. And so now B minus A over N, we have a name for that. What's its name?
Delta
X. And so keep in mind that what this is this is a, we're trying to figure out the average value of F. And what we said was, in our setup, we said, okay, let's sample F at N places, and then we're going to add up all of those places and divide by n. And this formula is a formula that does that. And so what is the calculus mantra? Right? If don't just sample it in places, sample it all the places, right? Sample it all of them. So so the calculus point of view is now we're gonna let n go to infinity, and this is the punchline.
Oh, this was a joke?
It yeah. It's not a joke. This is a real thing.
No, I know.
I mean, there is a little bit of a joke. And here it is. So, you have to tell me. I mean, really, this is the oldest calculus joke that there is. So, what is this? So, we're saying that this was the formula, and now I'm saying let's compute the limit as n goes to infinity of that formula. What is the limit? Okay, so you're telling me that this is a constant, so it stays a constant. Mm-hmm. And you're telling me that this bit right here becomes an integral? I claim that's hilarious. It's correct, first off. This is the integral, right?
Mm-hmm.
F of x dx. Mm-hmm. And why is this hilarious? Well, okay, this is called the average value formula. So let's say that. So this last thing is now a formula you must memorize. So this is the average value of F on A to B. But we still haven't gotten to the important part, which is why this is a joke. Why is this a joke? Why is this funny?
Because we didn't really have to go through all night. You've just given us the
fun. No, this is a... Okay. This is a university calculus course. I can't just give you a formula. I have to show you why this is the formula. Right? No, the reason why this is a joke is because, look, What letter is this?
Sigma.
Capital sigma from what alphabet?
The
Greek alphabet. And what is the phonetic Latin phonetic equivalent of Greek sigma?
Delta.
S. And what letter is this triangle letter?
Delta.
And what is the Latin phonetic equivalent of delta?
D.
So the joke is that, oh, we take this Greek thing, and then we compute a limit, and then all the Greek letters become Latin letters. Right? Greek capital sigma becomes Latin capital S. Greek capital delta becomes Latin capital, or Latin lowercase d. I guess that's a little weird.
Which we did that when we just did sum, too.
Right.
We didn't have the delta in there.
And what I'm saying is it's just as funny now as it was then.
Hilarious.
Okay.
You should take that on the road.
So.
Funny, too.
So here's the formula, right? So now I'd like to point out just how similar these formulas really are. So this one, this is now the discrete average. Because this is what happens when you take n discrete values, right? N separate values. And the way you compute average is you sum up the values, and divide by n, the size of the sample, right? This is exactly the same, except now you have a continuum of values. So integral is continuous sum. So you sum it all up and then divide by the size of the interval that you summed over. So it's exactly the same. It's sum things up and then divide by the size of the stuff. Sum things up, divide by the size. Yes?
So one thing that kind of confused me when we were doing like the fx1 plus fx2, and for some reason I was thinking those were different formulas, but they're not different formulas.
No, this is f evaluated at n separate places.
Okay.
That's the height.
The formula doesn't change.
No.
Gotcha.
That's the height of these n green values. Okay, so in the end, a formula to memorize. Okay, so let's do one. So I'll read it aloud first. Now let's just do it. So a stock analyst. Finds the price of, so let's Mad Lib it. What are we selling?
Peanut butter.
Peanut butter.
Stock analyst?
Yeah.
I hope there's not an equalized boundary.
This is a very special organic peanut butter.
Peanut butter.
Yeah. Finds the price of peanut butter per unit size or whatever is given by
per jar.
Well, this is going to be good peanut butter. Is given by S of T is 25 minus 5 exponential of negative 0.01 T, where T is in years. From now. This is shade grown, free range peanut butter. So T is in years from now, and this is the price. So find the average price from now until 6 years from now. To the nearest cent.
And see, what I want to do is just put in 6 there, but that's not correct.
No. That would tell you the price. If you just plugged in 6, that would tell you the price in 6 years.
It's now 0.
Now is 0. So T is in years from now. So, you know, conceptually, one way you could do this is you could measure, you could record the price of peanut butter every day for the next 6 years, and that'd be like a little more than 2,000 measurements. Right? You could make 2,000 separate measurements or so, and then add them all up and divide by 2,000. That would be an estimate for the average price of peanut butter. Okay, but that's just an estimate. How do we get the exact average?
By using the formula
you just gave us. Yeah, by using the formula. So does everyone see, we can use the formula. So we need to compute an integral. What is the interval of integration?
0 to 6.
So the average price is 1 over 6 minus 0, integral 0 to 6, and then 25 minus e to negative 0.01t dt. Is there any question why this is the formula? I did forget a 5. Yeah, this 5 right here, I didn't write it. Minus. Okay, now is there any question? Okay. So then, this is just 1 over 6, so I'll write 1 over 6 in a minute here, so right, even right now. So then we want to use the fundamental theorem, which means we would like an antiderivative of this. Do we know an antiderivative of this?
Yes,
we do. What's the antiderivative of 25?
25t,
right? And then minus, that 5 just hangs out. Do we know antiderivative of e to negative 0.01t?
Yes.
Yes. What is it?
5 over negative 0.01 e to the negative 0.01t.
Okay, something like that. So e to negative 0.01t, and then divided by negative 0.01. I think that's what you said.
Well, sort of. I just put the denominator underneath the 5.
All right, okay. So, any question about getting to here? So now, I'm going to make some simplifications. This is dividing by a negative, and this is subtraction, so those two negatives will cancel. Those two negatives will cancel. So that'd be a sixth, and then 25t, and it will be plus. Okay, and then this, the negatives go away, they cancel. 0.01 as a fraction is 1/100th. So dividing by 1/100th is the same as multiplying by 100. So division by this is the same as multiplication by 100. So this would be 500, because it's 5 times 100. And then e to negative 0.01 gesundheit t. So then 0 to 6.
Question, where did the plus come from?
Because this negative combined with that negative.
Okay, thank you.
And so this is probably as simple as it gets before we plug it into the machine. So I'll do that now. So 1/6, and then evaluate at 6. So 6 times 25 is 150, plus 500, e to negative 0.06. And then minus evaluated at 0, so that would be 0 plus. And then what is e to negative 0?
1.
1, right? So this would be plus 500. So this would be a sixth. 150 minus 500 is negative 350, and then plus 500 e to negative 0.06. And that's as good as I can get it before the calculator. Did I make a mistake?
No, I was just trying to follow.
So negative 350 plus 500. Times e to negative 0.06. I get 20.15. Okay, so if you have your calculator, I'll give you a minute to see if you can get 20.15.
Can I ask you a question regarding the equal signs? Because I noticed on my homework that they have filled in where I didn't continue doing the equal signs. Are we losing points on that, or are they just letting us know?
I'd have to look at it
okay.
on an individual basis.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Any questions about this exercise?
20.15.
Yes, the meaning of this number is that the average price is $20.15. So let's see if that passes the reasonableness test. What is the price right now? How do you figure out what the price is right now?
Oh, you, t is equal to 0?
Yeah, you plug in t is 0. So 25 minus 5 times the exponential of negative 0.01 times 0. So the price right now is 20. So prices go up. So far that seems reasonable. But what's another reasonableness check that we could use? Yeah, let's see what the price is at time 6. And if this is really the average, it's got to be between the price now and the price at time 6, right? So the price at time 6 is $20.29. Yeah. So that seems reasonable. Any question about this? Okay, let's have another. Okay. So I'm going to read the exercise out loud first. Otis plots the price per share of a stock and finds that it can be approximated by some totally unrealistic function of time. Find the average price of the stock over the first 5 years. Okay, so what do you suppose we're going to have to do? It seems like a weird question because the answer is so obvious.
We're going to plug it into the formula?
Yeah, we're going to use the average formula, right? Okay, so now I say that question because in the coming lectures we're going to collect a great many applications of the integral, right? So far we have at least two applications of the integral. One is to compute area, the other is to compute average. We have at least those two, right? And as time goes on, we're going to get more and more and more and more. So you need to be able to know what is your signal that you need to be using the average value formula. So you've got to be able to say, ah, that's my signal. So, yeah. So the signal is the fact that it says find the average price. That's your signal. Okay? So that seems obvious now, but in a few weeks it may seem less obvious. Okay. So Otis plots the price per share, and the price is given by the function S of t is t multiplied by 25 minus 5t plus 18. So that's the price function. And find the average price over the first 5 years. So this here is t in years from now. Okay, so what's the formula? Okay, and then integral 0 to 5, and then this thing, right? T 25 minus 5t plus 18 dx?
dt.
Okay. Okay, so here we are with another integral. Yay. Okay, so we'd like to compute this integral. So we start at the top of the Riesz procedure. Is this exactly one of the antiderivatives that we know? No. Is there something algebraic we can do to turn it into one or more of the antiderivatives that we know?
Yes.
I don't know, I kind of feel like I want to do integration by parts.
No thanks.
Okay, so why not? Why is the Riesz procedure saying, nah, maybe not?
We should be able to do some
algebraic. Yeah, you should do algebraic steps first. So can you multiply this out? Yeah, you can multiply this out, and that's what you should do. Okay. So 1/5 integral 0 to 5. And then, here, I'm going to write something that's just atrocious. 25t minus 5t squared plus 18 dt.
You should really make your t's a little fancier.
Yeah, so if you're writing your t's like this, you need to cease and desist doing that, okay, in a math class. So that's a plus, okay, and that's a T. They should be very distinguishable. Okay, otherwise what you run the risk of is you run the risk of angering the grader. Right? So don't do that. So T's have serifs, they have feet. Okay, so 1/5 integral 0 to 5, 25t minus 5t squared plus 18. And then do we know an antiderivative of this?
Yes.
Okay, so that'd be 1/5. Oops, I'm doing this now. So this would be 25 over 2t squared minus 5 over 3t cubed plus 18t from 0 to 5. And then the arithmetic's not so excellent, but at least one of the places to evaluate is zero, so that's not too bad. So it'd be a fifth, and then 25 over 2 times 5 squared, minus 5 over 3 times 5 cubed, plus 18 times 5, and then all of that minus 0. And that's as good as I can get before using the machine. Twenty-five over 2 times 5 squared minus 5 over 3 times 5 cubed. What? Whoa. 5 divide 3 times 5 cubed, and then plus 18 times 5. So I get 38.83. Okay. Any question about this one? So all of these questions in the end are the same somehow, right? Somehow I give you a function and I give you an interval and I say find the average price or find the average height or find the average whatever on this interval. So, but just to make this, just to test your understanding a little bit, what if it was the same situation, but now find the average price? Just write down the integral for finding the average price for the second 5 years. Yeah, 5 to 10 now, right?
When we're putting our answer, do we need to put like our unit or something? Like, for example, you say average price, you put like dollars or yen.
Yeah. Well, I do agree with that general thing, but I'll just leave that to your physical sciences classes for them to chastise you about units. So just a number will be fine. One over 10 minus 5. Okay, any question about this? Average. Everybody's quiet. I'm going to interpret that as everybody being very satisfied with this topic. This is a good one, okay. So, we're going to skip section 8.3 until next week. And we're going to do section 8.4 right now, which is called improper integrals.
Oh, my tutor asked if we'd be doing those, and I said no.
Here they are.
Yes, it was wrong.
Improper integrals, which I hope for you raises the question, wait a minute, they can be proper or improper? Wait a second. Okay. Well, remember that when you're computing an integral of a function over a region, then there's an associated area to the integral. And when the function in question is non-negative, then the integral, the value of the integral, is the same as your grade school notion of area when the function being integrated is non-negative. So when the function being integrated is negative some of the time, then you lose the connection between area now. So so Suppose we have F continuous on A to B. And if we had a function that looks something like this, say, then the integral in the end is accumulating the sizes of the areas of rectangles in two different regions, in this region and in this region. Okay. Which one of these regions would be reckoned as positive? The one above the axis. And the one below the axis would be reckoned as negative. So this integral is called proper because the region in question is bounded. And the best way to understand the meaning of that is that you take this region, it's possible to draw a circle around it. Okay, so then you could, for example, contain it within this circle. Okay. So we want to deal with integrals and shapes, therefore, where it's not possible to draw a circle around the shape. And the reason why is going to be because the shape is simply too big. It extends too far in one direction, say. Okay? So, for example, so is everybody okay with this? So this is the meaning of proper. If you can't draw a circle around it, then it's improper. So for example, find the area under f of x is, say, 1 over x squared on the interval 1 to infinity. And I want you to provide a sketch. Okay, so how does 1 over x squared look? X squared is a parabola. But what is 1 over x squared?
It's not an upside down.
It's not an upside down parabola. Negative x squared is upside down parabola. So first let's ask, is this function defined at every x?
No.
No. Okay, it's not defined at 0. Okay, so it has a division by 0 at 0. So as you go to 0, x squared is getting small. So this will go up to infinity as you go to 0. This is one of the parent functions that you're expected to know what it looks like in this class. So just FYI. So this one looks like On the right side, it looks like this. So, which is to say that as x starts getting big, as x goes to the right, then x squared starts getting really big, and 1 over x squared is going to 0. And as x goes to 0, then x squared is also going to 0, so 1 over that is going to go to infinity. And so it has this vertical asymptote here and a horizontal asymptote here. How about the left side? How does it look? It's going to look like this, right? Is it going to be down here?
Yeah, the first quadrant.
No.
This is the first quadrant. The second one. It's going to be up here. Why is it going to be up here?
No clue.
Because
it says x squared. If you plug in a negative x, you're going to square it, and then that will be positive, so 1 over that is positive. So that all the values that come out a function f must be positive. So it looks like this. So this is what f looks like. So what is the region that's being requested?
One to infinity.
So to make a kind of exaggerated version of that so that we can see what's going on, okay, so then if this is 1 here, then what is the region that's being discussed?
Under.
Everything under, mm-hmm. And that is to the right of 1. So this and can you see that this region extends infinitely far to the right? So do you observe that you cannot draw a circle around this region because it goes all the way that way? You cannot draw a circle big enough around it. So this region is improper. Region just has 1 eye. Yes?
So when you're doing like the bounded by the circle thing, because on the one that you showed us before, you had a function that was just within the section that you were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
But when you have something like, let's say you have 1 over x squared,
It's the region that matters. Yeah. So if we had said from 1 to 5, like you said, then that would be a region that looks like this. And would that be proper?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that'd be proper because you can draw a circle around it. The problem is that it's in this exercise is that it's saying 1 to infinity. So that's what's making it not proper. So if this had a value, if it had any kind of value, it would have to be given by this formula. The integral from 1 to infinity of 1 over x squared dx. But we cannot use the fundamental theorem on this. Because in order to use the fundamental theorem, you have to integrate over a finite interval, and the interval in question is not finite. So you cannot use the fundamental theorem. That's a problem, right? Because what is at the present time, what is the conclusion of not being able to use the fundamental theorem?
Impossible.
It's not that it's impossible. It's not that either.
Too hard.
Too hard. Okay, now we're getting warmer. Right, it's the one, if you have to compute an integral and you can't use the fundamental theorem, That means it's time to cut into rectangles. That's what it means. That's what it means. So wouldn't it be better if we had some way that we could still use the fundamental theorem, even on an integral that's improper?
Yes.
Yeah, that'd be terrific. So what we're going to do is we're going to do this in two steps. Proceed like this. Is that how you spell proceed?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Proceed in two steps. So what we're going to do is we're going to take the region in question and we're going to truncate it.
We're going to
cut it at some value. So we're going to go from 1 to what letter do you want to use?
Z.
So we'll go from 1 to Z. Okay, and we're going to just do that much. And I'd like for you to observe that this region now is proper. This one is proper. And because it's proper, that means that we're not prohibited from using the fundamental theorem. So what is the formula for the area of this region?
Integral from 1 to z.
Integral 1 to z.
1 over x squared.
1 over x squared dx. So then once we do that, once we figure out what the area from 1 to z is, then what are we going to do? Now let z go to infinity. So we're going to integrate from 1 to fence post z, and then we're going to grab that fence post and pull it all the way to infinity. Okay? So we're going to compute an integral, and then we're going to compute a limit. That's what I mean by two-step procedure. Okay, so does everybody understand the game plan? I was going to say, are you ready? But then I was expecting to hear, no, not really.
Z is not a number.
It's just a placeholder.
A placeholder.
If you don't like Z, you can use some other letter that's more preferable to you.
That's how we're plugging back in.
Right. You just can't use a letter that's already in use, right? We're already using F, we're already using X. Z was available. So the integral from 1 to Z of 1 over X squared dx. Okay. So this is an integral, it is proper, so that we can use the fundamental theorem. So let's try and find an antiderivative of 1 over x squared. Do we know an antiderivative of 1 over x squared?
This is step 2, right?
This is step 1. Currently we're computing a proper integral. So how about the antiderivative of 1 over x squared?
Is it?
So is this one of the ones that we know?
-2.
Yes, good. So, but for some, it still helps for me to write that, yes, this is x to negative 2 dx. So do you observe that this is power rule? So this would be x to negative 1 divided by negative 1. Evaluate from 1 to z. So I'm going to simplify this slightly. I'm going to simplify it slightly. One thing I'm going to do is this is division by 1 is just negative. So I'm going to spend this negative to do what?
Flip your...
To flip the order of evaluation. So then it would be x to negative 1 from z to 1. So I spent the negative to change the order of evaluation. And now I'm going to write x to negative 1 as 1 over x. So then, what's the answer?
It's going to be 1 minus 1 over z.
Yes, 1 minus 1 over z. So what that tells you is that for any value of z, that's how much area is in there. So for example, if z was 10, then the amount of area would be 1 minus a tenth. 1 minus a tenth. If z was 5, it'd be 1 minus a fifth, is how much area would be in there. So that tells us how much area is in here. So now what do we do?
Plug in infinity?
Well, plug in infinity is not a proper calculus lingo.
Okay, so we have to calculate the limit?
Limit. There you go.
Yeah.
So now limit as z goes to infinity. So the limit as z goes to infinity of 1 minus 1 over z is what?
1.
1, right? Because what's the limit of 1 as z goes to infinity?
0.
The limit of this is 1, right? And what's the limit of 1 over z as z goes to infinity?
0.
So the answer is 1. So what's the answer to the question? What was the question?
We're to calculate the...
Oh, calculate the region. Calculate it from
the area.
The area from 1 to
the area
infinity.
Is 1.
So the area is 1.
What?
The area between 1 to 3.
Sure, I'm happy
with
that.
1. Yeah, no, negative.
Oh, don't worry, it's going to get worse.
Awesome.
So why did we do the formula?
So this is 1 right here. 1 over x squared looks like this. Looks like this. And that shape is improper because it has an infinite extent. It goes all the way to the right. But the amount of area in there is 1.
Forever.
I mean, I believe you. Just going to go with
that. That's how much area is in there.
Wait a second. Are you just finding the formula so you can put in the limit for it? Are you just doing step 1 so that you can find the limit?
Right. So conceptually speaking, what we're saying is that look, this is a shape that goes too far to the right. It goes all the way to the right. So what we're saying is let's just cut it here at z. And then this shape is proper. I can draw a circle around it.
Right.
So that means that we can use the fundamental theorem. So we can find the area of this shape. And then we're going to grab this fence post and pull it all the way to the right. That's what the limit is. So it's a two-step procedure. It's cut and then pull.
So I guess for some reason I was thinking that at some point you'll have to solve this one in the top.
The answer is 1.
Okay. That's not gonna change.
No. So now I want you to imagine. What if you were making a fence? Okay, you're making a fence and its height was 1 meter and the length of the fence was say 50 meters long. How much area is that? 50 square meters, right? 50 times 100, or 50 times 1. So that'd be 50. So now what we're saying is that now imagine that you make a fence that looks like this. Okay, so that it's 1 meter tall, and then you move 1 meter to the right, it's a fourth of a meter tall, because 1 over 2 squared is 1 over 4. You move another meter to the right, it's 1 over 9 meters tall. So it's 1... It's 1 and then a fourth and then a ninth and then a 16th. So it's this It's a fence that has this shape right here. Imagine you had such a fence. Then you could paint it. And if you chose the units just right, then this would take one bucket of paint to paint. That's how much paint. Okay? And it goes infinitely far to the right. Now let's imagine what this means. Imagine what this means is that this is essentially a painting device, right? And maybe we could arrange the units so the amount of green it would take for me to fill this region in is exactly one pin, right? Exactly one pin. We could arrange it so it was that size. Now here's an interesting thing. This little bit, if I wanted to draw this line right here, this red, how long is that line?
Infinitely long.
Infinitely long. Which means that while this region has the property that I could fill it in with one green pin, there is no red pin that would suffice to draw that line. Because that line is infinitely long, and my red pin would run out of ink. We could turn all of the stuff in the universe into red pins, and that wouldn't be enough red pins to draw that line. But I could fill in this area with one green pin.
I hate talking about infinity. It's the worst thing ever.
We broke it. Yeah, it's broken. So, wow, that's a little bit disturbing. So this is really just the tip of the iceberg of pathological mathematical shapes and regions. So you can come up with say an object that contains exactly pi gallons of paint. That's its volume. But it would be impossible to paint it all because it has an infinite amount of surface area. So you could fill it with 3.1415 gallons of paint, but no amount of paint would suffice to actually cover it in paint. You can fill it, but not paint it. It's incredible to think about. So let's do another one. So let's do almost the same exercise. So here's this exercise. So let's do the area under. F of x is 1 over x on 1 to infinity. Provide a sketch. So what's the distinction between these two exercises? Yeah, one says 1 over x, and the other says 1 over x squared. So they seem reasonable, compatible, I would say. So 1 over x is also one of the parent functions that you are expected to know. How is it similar, and how is it different to this one? The left side is flipped down, right? The reason is because if you plug in a negative x, then 1 over x is negative. So this function would look like this. Okay, but the right sides are pretty similar looking. Right? Well, let's see. So, right, because we're only doing 1 to infinity, then we're not even including the left-hand side. So, that means that the region that we're actually interested in looks like this. Okay, and do you observe that this region is improper?
Yes.
Okay, and I'd also like for you to observe how quite similar, at least on my sketch, they look. So this one had area 1. The previous exercise, this one had area 1. So what do you think? Is this one going to be bigger, smaller, the same?
I think it's going to be smaller.
I think it's going to be smaller. Okay.
Could be the same. I think it's the same.
Think it's going to be the same, okay? So, this region is improper. Now, the integral for this area is what? For this area would be what?
Integral from 1 to z.
From 1 to, for this one.
Sorry.
Would be 1 to infinity, 1 over x dx. Now, the problem with this integral is that it's improper. So, that means that we can't use what? We can't use the fundamental theorem. So you can't do this one.
But
so but we can truncate it. Cut it and then pull that fence post to the right. So we'll do the integral from 1 to, let's use a different letter now. What do you think?
Q.
So from 1 to Q of 1 over x dx. So this one represents you're cutting at Q. And then when you cut at Q, it's proper because the region can be, a circle can be drawn around the region. So then now that this is proper, the fact that we've made it proper, we can use what thing that we really want to use?
FTC.
The fundamental theorem.
FTC.
Good. So then we can use the fundamental theorem. Let's use an antiderivative. Do we?
One that we know.
Okay, good. Beat me to the punch. Well, see, that's good because that means that when it comes to a quiz, you know, you're going to start hearing that, like, is this one of the ones
uh-huh.
that we know?
Yeah. Yeah. There's only 30 minutes hearing this.
Okay, so then what's the antiderivative of 1 over x? Log x.
Oh, thanks for saying that. I was trying to figure out what's going on.
From 1 to q. And then this would be, log q, because q is positive. It's to the right of 1. And then minus log 1. And what is the log of 1?
Zero.
So the answer is log of q. So would someone please interpret what this is, log of q? What does that mean? It means that how much area is between 1 and q for 1 over x. How much area is in there? Log q. In fact, in many, I think maybe I won't be too brave and say most, but probably most. I'll just say many. Calculus courses, scientific calculus courses, take this as the definition of the log function. The log function is defined as the amount of area between 1 and q. That's what log of q is. Okay, so we found the area of a proper region. Now to answer the question, what do we need to do?
Find the limit.
Find the limit as q goes to infinity. Good. So now the limit, as q goes all the way to the right, so the limit as q goes to infinity of the log of q. Well, what is that? It's infinite. It's infinite. So, which is to say, remember that if this is Q, then the log function looks like this. Right, that's log of Q. And the question is as you go to the right, how far does log of Q go up?
Forever.
It goes all the way up, right? It goes up excruciatingly slowly. But it goes all the way up. So what does that mean? What's the meaning of our answer?
The area is infinity.
That's how much area is in there. Infinite amount of area.
I don't get...
So I guess that's part of why I didn't understand that. I guess I didn't understand why, how the area of the other one was one, and why it wasn't infinity.
So just a minute. Let me finish drawing it.
No, don't have this thing. It's going to make your head hurt. It's making my head hurt.
So this is a plot of 1 over x. There is infinite amount of area in here. That's what we've just established. On the previous exercise, this was the plot of 1 over x squared. And at least according to my drawing, they look pretty similar, right? And I even asked, jokingly, at least in my head, so this one has area 1. How about this one? Is it going to be bigger? Is it going to be smaller, the same? There's infinite amount of area in this one. Infinite amount. That means that no amount of paint would ever suffice to paint this. Okay, but you could do this one with one bucket.
But why?
So the reason in the end, the reason this is the case in the end is because of what we've shown on this paper. This is the reason. So when you say why, I think you mean I find this really intuitive and I don't really unintuitive and I don't understand the reason why this is so unintuitive to me. Why am I so surprised that this one has area 1? And this one has area infinite. So I'll interpret your question in that way. So the answer is basically that you're a human being and human beings don't have very good intuition about infinity. In the end, that's the answer. It really is. As unsatisfying.
So she's onto something, as infinity is awful.
It is awful.
Well, is it mainly though because if you were to do ln and you multiply it by a very high number, you still get a pretty decent number, but if you do it 1 over infinity, it approaches 0, it just keeps approaching 0, and that's why. If you get closer to 0 versus the other way, you don't. Because if you do ln
right,
times
yes.
a very high number, you're still going to get a number, whereas 1 over infinity, you approach 0. It's 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, so it's
right.
really just 0.
So let's look at the analogous positions, I think, of what you're talking about. So on the previous exercise, we computed the limit of this, and it was 1. So 1 over z gets arbitrarily small, which is why this one worked out to be finite and 1. Whereas the limit of log of q gets arbitrarily big. So these two positions in those two exercises are analogous, and yes,
that makes sense.
Analytically.
That makes sense.
So now let's, I want to convince you a little bit about why and just in one particular way your human intuition about infinity is probably broken. Okay? So.
Is it a joke?
It is somewhat of a joke, I guess. So.
It's not going to be funny, too.
It's going to be funny. It's going to be funny.
In math.
Okay, so this is a thought experiment. A thought experiment that's really quite good, and I didn't come up with it. It's called Hilbert's Hotel.
Hilbert?
Yes. I did not. This was 100 years ago. Okay, so I want you to imagine the following scenario. That we have a hotel with four rooms in it. Okay, and every room except the first room is occupied by a person. And none of these people like to share rooms. Okay, so every room except the first room is occupied. And I want you to imagine that a green person shows up. And the green person says, I'd like to have a room. Is there room for the green person?
Yes.
Yes. Because this green person can be put right here in the first room.
Unless the three red have a double bed.
Oh, but, right, okay, yeah. These are all in not suites and none of that. Okay, so then now the green person showed up and said, can I have a room? And the hotel manager said, sure, there you go. So now a blue person shows up. And they say, can I have a room? What's the answer?
No.
No, they can't have a room.
We need to make these one-colored pen.
Okay, so then the hotel's full. So now I want you to imagine a scenario where we have a hotel, but now instead of having finitely many rooms, now there's infinitely many rooms. Right, and it just goes on right, to the right. And so now let's imagine that there are every single room except the first room is occupied by red people. So all of them are occupied except the first one. And then a green person shows up. Is there room?
Yes.
Yes. Now all of the rooms are occupied. Every single room has a person in it. And now a blue person shows up. Is there room for this blue person?
No.
Yes.
What?
Because the hotel manager just gets onto the PA and says, everybody, I need you to move down one room. I need you to move down one. So you're arguing about the practicality.
I thought math was logical.
Where we have a hotel.
Life is based on finite. There's nothing.
That's not true. That's not true.
What's infinite?
There's plenty of things that are infinite.
Clearly, the area of L,
the universe, would be infinite.
Everything can be measured in a finite number.
But the area of 1 over x is infinite.
So I'll just have to philosophically and mathematically disagree with you on that one.
Is so, there another hotel?
Yes, and we're going to continue with this thought experiment just a moment. So, I mean, you know, we've been doing calculus, and to perform an integral literally requires infinitely many steps. So, I, you know, sort of from that position alone, I find it odd that you raise your objection just now.
But it's in a finite region.
But we're cutting it into infinitely many pieces.
It's still in a finite region. In the end, you're coming to it.
And we also cut this region of infinite extent into infinitely many pieces.
Yeah, I mean,
I'm just registering my disagreement with this whole thing here. So yes, there's room, right? You just tell everyone to shift down. Right? So if you were in room 10, then your new room is room 11, etc. So what if another person showed up? Is there room?
Yes.
Sure. What if 100 people showed up? Is there room?
Sure.
Sure, right? Just say, move down 100 spots. What if infinitely many people show up?
There's room.
You can't tell people to move down infinitely many spots because you have to tell them what their room is.
Well, infinite number of people are never going to show up because...
Why not? There's infinitely many people already in there. It's a thought experiment. So what if infinitely many people show up and the hotel's already full? So let's say that it's...
But so, it can't be full if there's infinite number of rooms.
No, every single room is full. So you just tell me any number, any integer, positive integer, and that room is full. Room number 1,438,000 is occupied. All of them.
You're very matter of fact about it.
So they're all full. And now what if infinitely many green people show up?
They're out of luck.
Is there room?
No.
Of course there's room. Because I just get on the PA and I say, everyone, please take your room number and multiply it by 2, and that is your new room number.
Sorry.
That's your new room number. And why is that going to work?
Because whoever's in infinity can go to infinity times 2.
No one's in room infinity because that's not a room. For example, if you're in room 21, what's your new room number? 42. And if you were in room 1, what's your new room number?
2.
So who?
But there'll be spaces in between.
That's where the infinity people will.
That's the whole point.
That's bothersome.
Oh, I got too many hotels over here.
So after you tell all the red people, take your room, multiply it by your room number, multiply by 2, and they do that. Now every other room is open. So the infinitely many green people file into every other room. Okay, what if 2 groups of infinitely many people show up?
Times and times 3. Wait,
yeah, no. That is right, actually. You multiply by 3. And then you can start threading people in. So if 10 groups of infinitely many people, you multiply by 11, and you start threading people into the spots. Now here's a question. What if infinitely many groups of infinitely many people show up?
You times infinity times infinity.
Now it finally starts to matter, right? The question now becomes maybe. So if the size of infinity, because there's different sizes of infinity, If the number of people, number of groups that show up is countable infinity, then the answer is yes. If the answer is uncountable infinity, then the answer is, well, now it depends on a variety of factors. That are be, yeah. At any rate.
It never ends.
The point of this exercise is just to show you the brokenness, the possible brokenness and probable brokenness of your human intuition concerning things. So why did, here in this case, we just said, you know, I the punchline was, okay, everybody just move down. And it worked, right? Because if you're in room 100, then you were in 101. If you're in room 2 million, then you're in room 2 million 1. That's always going to work. Why didn't it work here?
Because there were only 4 rooms.
And if you told people to move down, the last person would fall off the end. Right? It wouldn't work in this case. It does work in this case. So this is a pretty stark example of why infinity can be, your intuition can break when there's infinitely many somethings happening. Okay, so then to come back to the question, which was, why am I so surprised that this one has area 1 and that one has infinite area? In the end, the answer is because you're a human and human intuition about infinite things is not very good. And that's not, you may not like that answer, but that's the answer. Good. So any question about this? Okay, good. So anytime you get a mathematician talking about infinity, then you got to get them off of it real quick. Otherwise, they just keep going.
Do you have an entire class on infinity? Do you study, is that what math is?
Well, this is the first course. This is the first course, the first math course. Well, Calculus 1 is the first math course where you're finally considering what happens when you have infinitely many somethings. So like computing a limit, you can think of it like taking a step toward the limit point. And you're breaking it down into infinitely many steps. Right? So like you step half of the way to the limit point, and then half of the way, and then half, and then half, and then half. If you always step half, then how many steps does it take to get there? Infinitely many. Right? So calculus is the first math course that anyone ever takes where there's infinitely many somethings. And then math generally fans out into where there's always infinitely many somethings, and you're trying to figure out all the consequences of that. Okay, so let's have another one. How about...
Are we still on the same section?
Yes. How about the integral from 0 to infinity of 4e to negative 3x... dx. So, an integral. Can we use the fundamental theorem?
Not yet.
No. Why not? Right. Limits can't be infinity. So the region in question is improper. So what's going to be our strategy? To truncate it to a proper integral. Okay, so first we'll make a proper version.
Are we going 0 to infinity?
0 to infinity. So we need to integrate 0 to some letter that we, let's use a new letter.
B.
0 to B, 4e to negative 3x dx. So because B is finite, that means that this integral is proper. And because this one is proper, what very good thing can we use? The fundamental theorem. Which means that we can do the find an antiderivative thingy. So do we know an antiderivative of 4e to negative 3x?
Yes.
Yes? This 4 is just hanging out. Okay, and then what's the antiderivative of e to negative 3x?
E to negative 3x over negative 3.
Very good. E to negative 3x divide by negative 3, and then now this evaluated from 0 to b. Okay, so a little bit of simplification would be helpful, I think. So I'll bring the 3 out to make it 4/3, and then e to negative 3x, and I'll spend this negative to do what? To switch the order of evaluation, so b to 0. And then I'll make one more simplification, or not simplification, but just to change it. I'll write it as 1 divided by e to 3x. I did lose the negative. From this step to this step, the negative went away. And why did it go away? Yeah, because I changed the order of evaluation. So 0 to b became b to 0. Yes, and this negative went away because it was moved to the denominator. Okay. So this would be 4/3, and then what do you get when you evaluate at 0?
1.
And then minus 1 over e to 3b. Okay, so that's a proper version. So that's truncating at B. So now what do we need to do?
Well, you could distribute.
Yeah, I don't want to.
Okay.
Because of what's about to happen. So now the limit. As B goes to infinity. So the limit as B goes to infinity of 4/3, 1 minus 1 over e to 3b. So what's the limit then?
I'm not sure.
Well, what's the limit symbol? What's moving? B is what's moving. So e to 3b is changing. So the question is in a sense, is what does e to 3b do as b goes to infinity?
It gets closer to 0 if
you read 0.
It gets infinitely large.
Just this thing by itself gets infinitely large, yes.
Yeah.
So 1 over it gets infinitely small. So this goes to 0. So this would be 4/3 multiplied by 1 minus 0. So 4/3.
Can you explain that one more time?
Which part?
The 3.
Here?
Yes.
So this is what y is e to 3b looks like. If that's a b and this is y. So as b goes to the right, e to 3b goes up, goes all the way up. So this gets, as b goes to the right, this gets infinitely big.
Right.
So 1 divided by something that's enormous is small.
Correct.
And that's it.
I guess y to small equals 0. That's where I...
What if you had a pizza and there were 2 people?
Mm-hmm.
And you cut it in...
I love the pizza example.
And you cut it in and you cut it into 2 pieces.
Mm-hmm.
Both people would get a lot of pizza. Right. What if you had 20 people? You cut it into 20 pieces. Now each person gets some, but not much. What if you have 20 million people?
Very tiny amount.
Okay, so then... Now, this gets big enough, right? Then, you know, everybody gets 1 atom, right?
Okay.
Right? Now it's getting smaller and smaller. So this denominator is getting infinite.
Right.
So 1 over it is becoming 0.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Just like this slice of a pizza being cut into...
Is that every fucking
pizza? I don't know. I mean, I imagine that's probably a pretty common...
It is pretty common.
Thank you.
Okay, so, all right. So here's a word problem. So the problem is, so imagine the following kind of scenario, that there's a factory and it produces waste products. And it's dumping it into a lake, say. Just dumping it in there. But the regulations say that the amount that they're allowed to dump has to decrease, you know, over time. And so the question is, well, if that's the regulation and if they follow it, then how much pollution are they going to dump in total? From now to the end of time, right? So they're doing a lot now. They'll do less next year. They'll do even less next year. What's the total amount that they'll dump in the whole year? Okay, so I'd like to make sure you understand why this word problem is indicating an improper integral. So it says, find the total amount of pollution from now until the end of time.
It goes to infinity.
Yeah, so now till the end of time is telling you that that's an interval of infinite length. What's telling you that it's an integral? Not interval, but integral.
No, I understand, but because there is an interval of time, mm-hmm. that's how we know it's an integral, because it's from A to B.
Can you restate what you said moments ago?
Find the total amount of pollution that will be released from now until the end of time. Mm-hmm. What's telling you integral? Total. Total is telling you integral. Because remember, right, sum, as in S-U-M, summation, that's total. That's a synonym for total. And when you have discrete values, that's discrete sum. That's mathematically symbolized by sigma. When you have a continuous sum, infinitely many values, what is that? What is continuous summation? Integral. That's what integral is. Integral is continuous summation. Summation, the thing that you knew before you got to this class, now for you is called discrete summation. Okay? So find the total amount of pollutant, the total amount of pollution that will be emitted from now until the end of time. So the fact that it says total, that's saying integral. The fact that it says from now to the end of time says from time zero to time infinite. That's telling you that the integral in question is improper. So does everybody see how the signals that tell you? And that's going to be important because, you know, in the future I'm just going to ask, there's going to come a time where I just ask a question out of the blue and you're just going to have to know, talking about average value or talking about improper integral or whatever. So here it is. Suppose the rate of pollution is P0 e to negative kt. So this is the amount that they're allowed to pollute in year zero. And then it has to exponentially decay. And the regulation statute says, well, this is 1,000, P0 is 1,000, and K is negative 0. Sorry, not negative, because that's negative already. So 0.02. So find total pollution from now until the end of time.
So K is just the amount that they decided they were
pulling. K is a parameter that says how fast this is going to decay. So if you plug this into your calculator, for example, 1,000 times the exponential of negative 0.02 times 0. So in year 1, they'll pollute 1,000, whatever that means. And then in year 1, or at year 1, the instantaneous rate of pollution is 980. And then at year 2, it's less, right, 960 or so. Now, if you make K different, so if you make K, say, 0.12 instead of 0.02, then it's different. So K is just some parameter that's just given to you. Okay, so then how do you answer the question?
So integral.
Mm-hmm.
Zero to infinity,
okay.
1,000.
Mm-hmm.
e to the negative 0.02 t?
Yes, dt. Very good.
Oh, I forgot.
So, in the end, this story, which would have been more, right, if I wasn't saying half of it out loud. In the end, this story is trying to say this, right, mathematically. It gets boiled down to this. So, here's an integral. Can we use the fundamental theorem?
No.
Why not?
Goes to infinity.
Right, it's improper. So, what will we do?
Truncate
it to a proper integral. So now integral 0 to what letter? M 1000 e to negative 0.02 t dt. This integral is proper, so we can use the fundamental theorem, and so it's a good idea to use the fundamental theorem. So this would be 1000 e to negative 0.02 t divided by negative 0.02 and then evaluated from 0 to m. So now I'll simplify this a little bit. So I'll spend the negative to reverse the order of evaluation. And then 0.02 is 2 over 100.
It's
two divided by 100. Or you can just type it into your calculator. Okay. So 2 over 100, well, that's 1 over 50. So division by 1 over 50 is the same as multiplication by 50 over 1. So this would be 50, and then 1, 2, 3 zeros. E to negative 0.02 t evaluated from m to 0. So 50, 1, 2, 3, multiplied by 1 over e to 0.02 t from m to 0. So one way or another, you've got to simplify some stuff to get it here. So 50,000, and then what do you get when you evaluate it? Zero.
50,000.
Okay.
One.
Right, okay. And then minus 1 over e to 0.02m. So that's if you truncate at time m. So what are we supposed to do now? Now the limit. So the limit as m goes to infinity of this thing, 50,000, 1 minus 1 over exponential 0.02m. So what's the answer? 50,000. Units of pollution. And again, so when you do an exercise like this, it kind of, you know, you might lose sight of how to geometrically interpret this. So, just as an aside, what this integral is saying is that if you were to plot this function with p as 1,000 and k is...
How did you get the 50,000 again?
Here?
Yeah.
Because 1,000 divided by 0.02 is 50,000. If you were to plot this expression, this is what you would see. You'd see... something that looks like this. What height is this at? What is it at? 1,000. That's at height 1,000. And this is the plot of function 1,000 e to negative 0.02 t. What is the exercise saying about this picture?
The area underneath the curve is 50,000 units.
That's what it's saying. How much area is under here? 50,000.
So it's saying over time, pollution drops.
What's saying is that the instantaneous pollution is dropping. How much pollution this polluter is emitting in time is going down. So what is the total amount of pollution that will be emitted for all time? 50,000.
Because it's an interesting concept given the fact that it's infinite.
Time is infinite, yeah.
Right, but you have a definite number. So that's what's kind of weird because with your hotel example, you have an infinite number of rooms. Where mm-hmm. this one, there's an actual number, even though there's no telling when
it stops. The analogy is that the room number in the hotel example is unbounded. So room numbers go arbitrarily big. The analogy here is that time becomes arbitrarily big, moving that way. Other questions? So in the end, what this section is about is that it allows you to think about regions that are not proper. Would you please remind me, what does it mean for a region and a region to be proper? You can draw a circle around it. If you can't draw a circle around it, it's not proper.
And that will always be if it's more like infinite.
Yeah, essentially what it comes down to is that an integral is not proper if the region it's dealing with is not proper. And in our class anyway, that's always going to mean that one or both of the limits is infinite. There's other ways that a region can be improper. So this region is improper because it goes all the way to the right. So you can't draw a circle around it. But we could turn it like this, and then now it doesn't it goes all the way up, right? So it only goes finite distance to left and finite distance to right, but now it goes all the way up. So this is a region that's improper, vertically improper, you might say, instead of horizontally improper. But we only deal with this kind of improperness in this class. What, impropriety?
Impropriety.
Okay, we only deal with this kind of impropriety in this class. Okay, so that's it for today. Have a nice weekend.